Okay, so it's my turn to present. I am Francesco Orlandi, I'm based in Exeter, and I'm going to speak about an heritage, an archaeological heritage site in northwest Argentina. Before starting, I actually want to say something about the colonial theory, which was part of the introduction that I skipped because of the all the logistic difficulties. So I will take just a few minutes before entering, but it's important because the presentation has, although I'll not be quoting directly the scholarship of the colonial theory, the presentation and my research project is framed within that. So, the colonial theory focuses on understanding modernity within the framework of a changing and ongoing colonial matrix of power. This critical scholarship is mainly associated with a group of scholars from Latin America, among them Aníbal Quijano, Walter Mignolo, Ramón Grasfogel, Catherine Walsh, Enrique Dussel, Santiago Gastro Gómez. The main concept developed by these authors is that of coloniality, which Mignolo defines as, and I quote, "the underlying logic of the foundation and unfolding of Western civilization from the Renaissance to today." As shown by Quijano, coloniality produces social discrimination, eventually codifies as racial, ethnic, national, according to specific historic, social, and geographical context. The coloniality emerged along with coloniality, through local practices that opposes themselves to the different universalism which have been succeeded since the 16th century onwards, such as Christianity, civilization, progress, development, but also democracy and human rights. The project of the coloniality, thus, is one of delinking from Eurocentrism, the idea that the history of human civilization has been a trajectory that departed from nature and culminated in Europe. This is an all-encompassing concept, which is the point zero, or the God perspective, in the words of Castro Gomez, around which gravitates the modernity and its darker side, which is colonialism. The integration, basically the aim of this session was of trying to explore the connection between the colonial theory and archaeology through different case studies, which is very interesting because although it's framed in Latin America, as we were discussing, Latin America is a kind of other West, as an Italian historian called it. So its part is the very mirror of what happened during the last 500 years. Matter of time is central to the colonial project, since Europe as a concept has been built upon linearity. A decolonial archaeology should be aimed at delinking from this conception of time, letting emerge other epistemologies covered by the point zero perspective of the modern colonial matrix of power. An archaeology does that put in relation the epistemology of the South, as it has been described by, for example, Boaventura Sosa Santos or Arturo Escobar, with relational ontology and epistemic disobedience. So, now the presentation can start after these preliminary words, which were essential to frame it. And I mean, I didn't have time to write it up, so I will just show you some picture, basically, of my preliminary fieldwork that I carried out last summer, which was winter there, so I mean, between July and August, basically, in northwest Argentina. So, So this is a map, two maps of Argentina, actually. One is indicating here the site, the archaeological site which I'm referring to, which is called Quilmes. is about 2,000 kilometers from Argentina capital, Buenos Aires. This other map show the political situation of indigenous reemergences in the country since 1994, a constitutional reform recognized the right of indigenous people, basically. So since this date, since 1994, indigenous people in Argentina are entitled to constitutional rights. But actually, the struggle for having these rights recognized dates a long back. So I will focus in the northwest, where is the main, let me show it here, which is this dark blue zone, which indicates the Aguita people, which is the indigenous people from this zone, that cover actually three provinces of the northwest: the province of Salta, of Catamarca, and Tucuman. And Tucuman is the province in which my fieldwork has been carried out. I will be returned there. So this is a picture I've taken in Tucuman, capital city. Argentina is a federal country, so each province has its own constitution and its own form of the relationship with indigenous people, indigenous rights. Tucuman is actually a good place for indigenous people to live, because the rights of indigenous people formally are respected. But for example, this was a march for claiming justice for the murder of an indigenous leader. So there are still discrimination and problems, especially in relation with the land title. But I will speak about heritage and the struggle for heritage by a community, an indigenous community belonging to the Aguita people, which is the community of Quilmes, and the struggle of the community of Quilmes to reappropriate his principal heritage has been very hard, as I will show. This is a signal at the entrance of the archaeological site that shows the legitimacy of the claims of the community, of the indigenous community, after the struggle, basically. But this site was known locally as the fortress, El Fuerte Viejo, then scientifically described as ruins. And then in the process of the reappropriation, the indigenous community of Quilmes starts to call it its sacred city. So establishing an historical legacy to this heritage that legitimizes their claim for rights, which are related to land, basically. This is a view of the valley in which is located the site. You see, it's actually a valley, so there are mountains in both parts of the valley. These are the Calchaquí valleys. Calchaquí is a name that will recur every time. And these shadows are the other mountain, which are called Aconjija, or also Quilmes. Okay, so another feature on the landscape is this, which is the Santa Maria River that gives the name to the valley. And this is the road which has been built to get access to the site and here from the main road, which pass along, which follow the river, basically. Okay, so in this scene also, I put the picture because it show how the management of the site, which now is in the end of the community, has been appropriated by the provincial government. And also the name, the Ciudad Sagrada, so the sacred city of Quilmes, it's actually now the name through which the site is publicized for tourism, basically. Okay, so some coordinates are killed for, I mean, where, why in this picture they called the Ciudad Sagrada de Quilmes, the sacred city of Quilmes, has the strength of an ancestral people, because the history of Quilmes people is actually very related to the history of Argentina as a country since colonial time. Before the colonial times, so in the time which is archaeological, the time which is prehistory, I mean, archaeology has always been focused on what happened before the arrival of the colonizer, of the Spanish, in this case. I mean, archaeological investigation has put the Quilmes site in the period which is called in the chronology of South America's regional development, which is a period after the fallen of the two main statal organization. Every region develop in his own way with its own material culture, such as these vessels which are now in the museum, ethnographic museum of Buenos Aires, which is called Ethnographic Museo Ambrosetti, which is another name that we will see in a bit. And this is a kind of chronology of resuming chronology of what happens in this region before the independence of Argentina, which was in 1816. After Quilmes, the site of Quilmes was the center. I mean, it's intended to be the center of this regional development of the Diaguita people. Archaeologically, is known as Santa Maria culture for the river, for the name, for the city. And at the end of the 15th century, this region was incorporated into the Inca domain until the invasion of the Spaniards, which was not easy. And actually, the site, the archaeological site of Quilmes, is known, is very famous for being the last refuge of the Quilmes people or the Diaguita people during 130 years. So since 1535, which was the date when Spanish arrived, until 1666, when the Quilmes people were remaining there, were being forced displaced to a city near Buenos Aires, which then became a city known as Quilmes, and they and the people, almost 2,000 people, were forced to walk almost 2,000 kilometers until they arrived near Buenos Aires, where they were made slave, basically. So the royal title is another story that I will tell you maybe another time. Okay, then what happened when Argentina became a republic? When Argentina became a republic, they start to imagine the community using a very known expression by Anderson, no? And this imagination of community in Argentina has been shaped by what Rita Segato called an ethnic fear. So the fear of the ethnic, a fear of alterity. Argentina start to imagine itself as an European country oriented by this vectorial linear time, and oriented as well by a line of color, which basically discriminates between what is white, what is good, and what is bad, which is the not white, and start a process of determination of aboriginality, according to Claudia Briones, which is a quite known scholar, Argentina scholar. And I've put here two quick shortcuts to understand what is this determination of aboriginality, which is actually working until now. It is a process that starts with the imagination of after the independence, but is actually working until now. For example, this map show what was Argentina when it declared the independence. It finished here, which is basically all this blue region was recognized actually as an indigenous land, as the Mapuche land. So after the independence start a lot of literature that claims that Mapuche are actually Chilean, but are now Chilean, so they are invasion, they are invading our Argentinian territory. So we have to, we as Argentinian, to put them away, basically. The process that has been called the conquest of the desert, which is a kind of oxymoronic expression to indicate the colonization of a region. And while in the south was occurring that, in the northwest start a process of put the indigenous in the past, a process that Fabian, for example, in anthropology called the allochronicity, so putting people in the past for reducing them to an homogeneity time and culture of the nation state. This is the northwest, and I'm showing that because actually, although the Quilmes were forcibly displaced in the near Buenos Aires, the toponym, at least the toponym of Quilmes, remain in the geography, such as in this map of 1863. You can see here the Nevado de los Quilmes, so this mountain that we were seeing before, they are actually called Quilmes. Quilmes is also a place here where there is a cross here, so maybe it's indicating a shrine or some church that was there. But the important thing is that actually the site was known as Quilmes since colonial times, during in the Republic as well. It was known, but it was not known scientifically. During the last quarter of the century, a lot of travelers were describing the ruins of the city. But the first scientific publication is that of this guy that I mentioned earlier, Juan Ambrosetti, that start to imagine how these ruins, these stones that he was seeing in the field, could have been. So it start to imagine and reconstructing the appearance of the site. And also extrapolating this symbolic element, which are now very part of the process of performance of indigenous identity. At the entering in the 19th century, in the 20th century, actually, things start to change a little bit. Ambrosetti was concerned about the people who were living around the site. He knows that the site were known by the people. And actually, he wrote in his diary that to convince local peasant to work for him and excavate basically the ruins, they convinced them, well, by paying and by letting them carry out some ritual before excavating especially human remains. And for example, this phrase, tat antiguo cocea me obligaron a hacerlo, which may be translated as old father, but it's actually tat antiguo is the human remains, is the skeleton, is actually there in the field. Choose some coca leaves, cocaea. They forced me to do that. So it's a kind of the peasant. We can imagine this little kid here doing this ritual, paying, which is the verb that is used in the Andes to referring to this relationality to the other than human, so with the material that's surrounding them. So he was paying that by giving to the tat antiguos, to his ancestor, some coca leaves, coca is the sacred plant on the Andes. I give it as a assuming, but yeah. And then things start to changing, as I was saying, because, for example, this guy Manuel Zavaleta, which was a police officer, a local police officer, and he was the biggest looter of Argentina. And I mean, this picture showed that there was not this kind of responsibility, or at least acknowledging of other kind of being relation with the archaeological site by local people. This picture show the old osteria, which was the place where was convocated the first indigenous parliament in the region after that. During the 60s, the sugar cane industry, which was the main industry, which is actually until now the main industry in Tucuman, were severely dismantled. And this make a turning point, because the parliament, this event, was celebrated in 1963, and it was a kind of agglutination of this movement, which was peasant movement actually in the 60s, and they start to become more ethnically oriented. So the indigenous that was assumed as totally disappeared in Argentina start to call themselves as indigenous. But this process was interrupted by the dictatorship in Argentina that started in 1966 until 1983. It's important, Quilmes, because it's a kind of multi-temporal landscape. We see that the story of these stones carry an history which dates at least from the 10th century. Then it passed through the conquest, the Spaniard conquest. It is related also to the building of a national community, or a sense of being Argentinian after the independence. During the self-proclaimed national reorganization period, which was how the dictators called themselves, Quilmes is also involved, because it's actually the main reason was the World Cup of 1978, where Tucuman was not part of the World Cup. So the governor of which is this this old man here in jacket want Tucuman to be part of this this global event. So he start to develop a tourist agenda for Quilmes, for the region, specifically in Quilmes. So they start to rebuild basically what were the remains, and they also did a museum. This aerial photography show the extension of the reconstruction during the 1978. This is the museum, but it's actually, I don't know if you can perceive yet, but the extension of the site is much greater than the this area. All these are all is part of the site, but it has not been rebuilt. This is how it looks like today, with the wall totally rebuilt. You can appreciate also from here, which is basically the absence of cactus, which marks the difference. This is the museum, but there are other structures here, which leads us to the other moment of Quilmes, which was during the 90s, when the neoliberal government of Argentina started to start to sell everything that was public, among other thing also cultural heritage. So the government was the site was giving concession to a local entrepreneur who built there a restaurant, an hotel with swimming pool, and also a market. The swimming pool is kind of very important point, because this is a very arid region, a very dry region. And I was told that the seeing people taking swimming in the swimming pool when people that don't have water to live was a kind of dramatic thing for people, that lead to claim for the restitution of the city as well. The moment in which the city was returned to the community started to organize as a community during the 80s. Grow ups, it took power from the constitutional reform. And in November 2007, when the concession of the was finished from 5 years, they start a roadblock. So they put an end to the to the private owning of the site. So the police intervene, finally applying the constitutional prerogative of the community. This is a community ceremony when the site were reappropriated in January 2008. And since then, the community, these people don't know how to manage heritage. I mean, they presume that they don't know how to manage heritage as the province, the state, or international organization want that the heritage had to be managed. So they start to have contact. They start a contact with the local National University of Tucumán. And this is a workshop in which participate Marisa Lazari, who is now my supervisor in Exeter. But then things got little crazy. A splinter group tried to control the site. One the first time in November 2013, and then he succeeded in 2014. In June 2015, the leader, the cacique, the community authority, tried to occupy the city, and it was a very big fight with several injured, and Francisco Chaire, the cacique, was arrested. And in such a hectic situation, a group of tourist guides occupied the administration of the site, and it is now the group who is running the site, establishing with the endorsement of the province, and a new local museum is going to be inaugurated. The local museum appears something like that from a reconstruction, picture that has been showed by local newspaper. This time there is another shifting in the name of the archaeological site. It's no more referred to as the sacred city, but a more neutral archaeological site of Quilmes. This is the part that was not touched by the intervention of during the dictatorship. This signal read don't pass through urban zone with no restoration, which I was saying it's full of cactus. And cactus are important because, according to local knowledge, cactus are actually people who transformed themselves in cactus when the Spaniards achieved to enter to Quilmes. And this is another site in the same community. And I put the picture because it may show how it looks like Quilmes like before the interventions. Okay, so now by concluding, I would like to introduce this concept by showing this image of the Indian astrologer poeta. And I'm going to quote Silvia Rivera Cusicanqui, who is a Bolivian sociologist. And I quote, this image, she explained this image in this way. This is a man who knows how to grow food in spite of historical contingencies. This is a poet in the Aristotelian meaning, creator of world, food producer, knower of the cycle of the cosmos. The poiesis of the world, which takes place in the walk, in the quipus that register memory and regularities of astral cycles, appears as an evidence and a proposal. Indigenous alterity may be seen as an other universality, which opposes to the chaos and to the colonial destruction of world and life itself. So why I putting this concept now? And because all of this history may be rethought in the line of indeterminacy, basically, and trying to reframe the linearity of time, which I follow during this presentation, by not thinking that the past is in our shoulder, while what we are seeing with our eyes is the future, but moving and doing moving the way around and seeing with the eye the past and caring with the future in our shoulder. Some conclusion: Quilmes is a great example of a multi-temporal landscape crossed by the practices of past and present social actors, both human and non-human. The very politicized situation around the management of the site has made the community of Quilmes struggle for the land to come out, along with the ontological disagreement on which indigenous history is deemed to be preserved and for whom. Heritage in this framework acts as a disciplinary material discursive practice in which the common interest of the community and the state are potentially put together for the benefit of an alleged tourism development of the region, which determines the ongoing multicultural production of the allowed Indian. A political ontology of heritage entails reconsidering its foundation through a process of uncommoning in which an undisciplined archaeological knowledge is produced from the relation of people and territory, that is, from the political activation of relationality. And I finished. I think I take a lot of time, I'm sorry, but no one stopped me. So I. Okay, and thank you very much.